Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Church of Spokane, where our mission is to join together to create a nourishing, liberal religious home and to champion justice, diversity, and environmental stewardship in our wider world, or in short, to create community, find meaning, and work for justice. Good to see all of you this morning. Great to have you. I want to begin, as always, by welcoming and embracing all that you bring with you, all of your uniqueness, your unique beliefs, your background, your lifestyle, your experiences, all that help make you who you are, is welcome here today. And this includes, of course, those who hear us say this each Sunday morning, as well as those who might be hearing it for the first time today. You're equally as embraced and welcome, and it always includes those who are streaming with us as well. We're so glad to have you. And while I'm saying that, I think we'll just go ahead and take care of this right now. I understand that our friends at the partner church, at our partner church in Felsorakos, Romania, are streaming with us live this morning, and I wanted to give you a chance to say hello. So what I'm going to do, we have Adam's turning the camera on you right now. And if you want to kind of maybe turn and look at the camera and wave to everybody and say hello to... Yes, good to know that you all are watching with us this morning and that you tune in. You are with us fairly frequently, Reverend Palco and our friends the Petos and many others I know are up late watching us, so good to have you. Look forward to seeing you this summer. Oh, happy Mother's Day. Yeah, I know even first service we had a lot of folks visiting so they could be here on Mother's Day to be with their mom, so happy Mother's Day to all of you. I think it's such an important day, not only to remember our mothers and those who have mothered us in so many ways in our lives. And last night I actually was talking with a gentleman who says that his kids always send him Mother's Day cards because he helped mother them as well. But I think, you know, we also shouldn't lose the origins of Mother's Day, which was really not about honoring our mothers as much as it was mothers honoring their children by wanting our government to stop sending them off to unnecessary wars. It was really an act of mothering in and of itself, of that fierce protectionism of children and the recognition that children should be nurtured and cared for and protected. Yes, that's right. And I'm going to be, you know, coincidentally talking about education in a little bit, which I think is a big part of that mothering as well, or should be, in our society. So anyway, happy Mother's Day to all of you today. I also want to let you know that one of our wonderful employees, Diane Critchlow, this is going to be her last Sunday with us, at least as an employee. She's been with us about a year as our membership coordinator and is going to be resigning because her husband, George, recently retired from Gonzaga Law School, and they are going to be downsizing and considering what the next steps are for them. And I hope you guys know that the doors are always open and that you're welcome to be here as much or often as you want to or can be. And we're going to get, yes, and Diane, thanks so much for a wonderful year of giving kindness and a great welcome to folks in our church. And we're going to, yeah. And we're also going to have an opportunity to say goodbye to her during social hour. There's a cake back there, so please have a slice of cake and be sure and thank Diane for all she's done for us. And I want to let you know about an opportunity that came up really just a couple of days ago, or I would have tried to promote it through other means, but a wonderful opportunity to hear a presentation from Dunya Perez in our chapel about 12:45. So I'll give you a chance to get some coffee and whatnot, some cake. But Perez is a Honduran feminist and human rights attorney associated with Radio Progreso and ERIC, the Jesuit Center for Reflection, Investigation, and Communication. She's with a group of other human rights workers who are visiting about 12 locations around the U.S. this week to talk about the erosion of democracy in Honduras, the violence against journalists there, and of course Trump's decision to begin deporting Honduran refugees who've been here for years, fearing for their lives. And then the entire group is planning on speaking with our Congress this Thursday to try to dissuade them from some of the policies that are detrimental to Hondurans. So that, again, is going to have about an hour, starting around 12:45 in our chapel after service. So with that, let's do take a few moments to greet one another. I hope, as always, you'll say hello to those you look forward to seeing each Sunday, as well as making some new friends today. If you are joining us for the first time, please don't be shy. Extend a hand. Somebody will be very happy to greet you.
Yeah.
Thank you. And as always, there'll be more opportunity to visit one another during social hour after the service, so I hope you'll stick around for that. We are going to move forward now by lighting our chalice, the symbol of our faith, the symbol of our unity and our solidarity, of our openness and our inclusion, of our community and our individual uniqueness. May this small flame be our offering of warmth to those who are cold and alone, and a light to those in darkness. May it be a flame that ignites justice in our world, and a beacon of hope to those in need, and may it reflect at least a spark of truth wherever truth has been lost, and cast a healthy shadow of doubt wherever it's been found.
So what do we mean when we talk about education? Paulo Ferrari said, education is a process of inviting truth and possibility, of encouraging and giving time to discovery. Or as John Dewey put it, education is a social process, a process of living and not a preparation for future living. The task is to educe, related to the Greek notion of educare, to bring out or develop potential. Such an education is deliberate and hopeful. It is learning we set out to make happen in the belief that people can be more. Education is informed, respectful, and wise, a process of inviting truth and possibility. Education is grounded in a desire that all may flourish and share in life. It is a cooperative and inclusive activity that looks to help people live their lives as well as they can. Inherent in education is respect. Respect, says R.S. Dillon, is when we have something we value and we value it enough to make it our focus and to try and see it for what it is rather than what we want it to be. It is so important that it calls for our recognition and regard, and we choose to respond. Maria Montessori, in her vision of cosmic education, puts appreciating the wholeness of life at the core. Since it has been seen to be a necessity to give so much to the child, she says, let us give him or her a vision of the whole universe. The universe is an imposing reality and an answer to all questions. We shall walk together in this path of life, for all things are part of the universe and are connected with each other to form one unity. Mark K. Smith from George Williams College brought all of these ideas together when he suggested, education is a process of inviting truth and possibility. It can be defined as the wise, hopeful, and respectful cultivation of learning, undertaken in the belief that all should have a chance to share in life.
Our first in-service hymn of the morning is Lady of the Season's Laughter. I dedicate it to all the women in the room who are goddesses incarnate, according to this text, and to all the divine feminine in each of us. The words are by Unitarian minister Kendall Gibbons. Please rise as you're willing and able to sing 51, Lady of the Season's Laughter. Thank you.
My name is Aria Curtis, and I am the Director of Children and Family Ministry here at UUCS. This is the time during the morning when we would normally have our story for all ages, but this morning we're going to do something a little different. I'm taking advantage of this moment in the service to recognize the accomplishments of some of our youth and honor the adults who went on the journey with them. I am speaking in particular of the Our Whole Lives program. Our Whole Lives, or OWL, is a comprehensive sexuality education program developed in partnership between our Unitarian Universalist Association and the United Church of Christ. With courses for children, youth, and adults of all ages, OWL covers everything from STIs and contraception through gender identity and sexual orientation. It is based in science, and the entire premise is to be giving people accurate information about their sexual being. Many of you have been on the receiving end of my passion, excitement, and drive about the programs we offer at UUCS, so I hope you know that I do not say this lightly. Our Whole Lives is one of the most important programs that we as a denomination and as a congregation offer to the world. If we can do nothing else, we must do OWL. This program is our faith in action. It is an act of justice to offer it, and it can be, if not life-saving, life-altering. Because in OWL, we do not just learn the frameworks of sexuality, we learn about consent, the importance of choice, and how to build healthy relationships. The weight of that on our shoulders as a community is heavy, but it is a weight I hope you take great pride in carrying, because without a community that supports it, OWL would not be possible. So before I bring up our most recent graduates of OWL, I would like to say thank you. Professionally, on behalf of the families in this community, thank you for making OWL available. And personally, as a Unitarian Universalist whose own life was changed by the Our Whole Lives program, thank you for continuing to make this available. Now, I'm going to invite some of our youth, or the youth who completed OWL this year, to come forward as I read their name and accept an admittedly silly gift of recognition. Allison Jones, Anna Worthlin, Lou Palmer, Bryce Merrill, Coyote Palmer, Ellie Adams, Ethan Nakos, Wynn Teal, Isabella Dallas, Yosef Sloma, Noah Kaselke, Robin Roos, Sawyer Burchett, and Sophia Ocker. Mother's Day. Completing OWL is no joke. Depending on your group, you spent either 27 sessions or 14 sessions participating in this program. It is an incredible amount of work, and we are proud of you for completing it. Maybe. Now, it is profoundly important that we honor the adults who facilitated the OWL program. They also spent 27 or 14 sessions in OWL, plus time planning and preparing the sessions, and a significant amount of time being trained. So when I read your name, please come forward to receive an also admittedly sort of silly gift of thanks. Gordon Teal, Harvey Kane, Jesse Duran, Kate Johnston, Kelly Matthews, and Mari Kellogg. Thank you, and congratulations to all of you for completing the junior and senior high OWL programs of 2017 and 2018. Now, please join me in singing our children and youth to their religious education classes with the hymn 413, Go Now in Peace.
As a grateful congregation, we are generous in heart, mind, and spirit. We offer so much of what we have in time, skills, and financial support to our thriving and growing ministry. To this end, we now gratefully give and receive this morning's offering, which sustains this community and our mission in the larger world.
Thank you, Michelina. We're now going to kindle our candles of care for those who are most on our hearts and minds. I want to begin with one for Mary Monroe, who is recovering from hip replacement surgery this week after a recent fall. She's at Touchmark if you want to go visit her. And James Mirren, who is at St. Joseph's recovering from having his ankle replaced this week. They're both going to be laid up for several weeks. They have to keep weight off of those joints. So please keep them in your mind. And then also, again, want to say congratulations to our friend Elamir Petto Jr., who is one of our friends in Fel Chiracos who came to visit us last summer. Elamir Jr. Passed his Romanian language exams, which are an important part of what they do in that country, and therefore will now be able to move on to college. So congratulations to him for passing his exams. He's going to, or at least plans to enroll in a hospitality culinary course in Budapest and to get his driver's license this summer. So Elamir, congrats, buddy. Let's take a moment of silence now on behalf of others that you might be thinking of, and as always, you're welcome to name them aloud at this time if you'd like. Those named aloud and those embraced in our silence and all those who are suffering in our world at this hour, we hold in our community with compassion.
So now we have a moment of reflection. So get yourself comfortable. Close your eyes if you're willing. Take a deep breath and relax. We all serve as teachers in some regard. So take a moment to reflect on how these attributes are reflected in your own life. The appreciating of others, being open to truth in its various guises, developing the capacity to reflect, being knowledgeable about yourselves and what makes people tick and about the systems of which we are a part, and being discerning, able to evaluate and judge situations appropriately.
For our reading today, I invite you to turn with me to number 548. I wanted to say 68, but 548. And we'll read this responsively. And why don't we ask this side of the room to start today, and this side can be our respondents. And we can all close on the last line together. After the weather we're finally having, this feels appropriate. Maybe it's just too hopeful at this point, but we stand at the edge of summer. People find a lightening of the burdens with the brightening of the day.
Every mother's prayer.
to a place where we'll be safe. Lead us to a place. Guide us with your
Brittany, thanks again so much for sharing your gift with us this morning. And Michelina, always for your accompaniment. Thank you. I hope my sermon is as enjoyable hearing a second time as your song was. Okay, thank you. Thank you. So this morning's message is the first in a series of sermons that I intend to offer just about every other week for the next several months, which I then intend to use as the basis of a book on the topic I audaciously call Ending Evil. And for our purposes, I'm calling this the Measure of All Things series, based upon those ancient words of that 5th century BCE Greek philosopher Protagoras, who caused much controversy in his day by saying, "Humanity is the measure of all things." More recently, following the horror of Nazi Germany and the Holocaust, social psychologist Eric Fromm, in his quest to understand how such a horror could have even happened, wrote an inquiry into the psychology of ethics, in which he takes Protagoras' statement to a new level by claiming that humanity should also be the measure of all ethics. Materially, he said, it is based on the principle that what is good for humanity, and evil, what is detrimental to humanity. Such a statement might cause many of us to cringe, just as it did when the Greeks heard Protagoras say it 2,500 years ago. And this is because, I think, by and large, we have a negative view of human nature. We think an ethic based only upon what we think is good for ourselves will lead precisely to the kind of world that we live in today, a world of grave economic, racial, gender, and national inequality, a world in which more than half of its countries are led by authoritarian dictators, a world with the most destructive technologies in human history resulting in the continuing and renewed threat of nuclear war, and of course, the environmental apocalypse we're in, we refer to as global warming. In light of all of this, it seems easy to conclude that the world's major religions got it right, that human nature is innately sinful, as we've been taught in the West, and that human desire causes suffering, as Eastern religion claims, and that we need their external teachings and forces to keep us from utterly acting out in our own interest and destroying everyone and everything in the process. For this reason, as Sigmund Freud once said, civilization has to be defended against the individual, and all of its regulations and institutions and commands are directed to that task. Fromm would argue our problem is not human nature, but the very regulations, institutions, and commands meant to suppress it. including religious institutions that constantly remind us how bad we are, that we can't trust ourselves, that we must control our human urges, and that only they can save us from ourselves because we are innately flawed, selfish, destructive beings. Fromm presents us with a far more favorable view of our humanity, a humanity we need not feel ashamed of or be afraid of. His is not a humanity that must be constrained and controlled by society and its norms, but freed from their very burden, and that we should be allowed to fully develop and express ourselves. For unlike our regulations, our institutions, and our laws, which are the true root and cause of injustice and humanity, unfettered humanity is rooted in love and relationship to ourselves, others, and to our environment. Our humanity is not the problem, it is the solution. And the solution society imposes upon us in its need to restrain individuality, which can only be fully expressed through freedom and respect, are the real causes of most our problems. Here's what Fromm says. For the principle that good is what is good for humanity does not imply that human nature is such that egotism and isolation are good for humanity. It does not mean that humanity's purpose can be fulfilled in a state of unrelatedness to the world outside. In fact, as many advocates of humanistic ethics have suggested, it is one of the characteristics of human nature that humanity finds its fulfillment and happiness only in relatedness to and solidarity with its fellow human beings. However, to love one's neighbor is not a phenomenon transcending humanity, he says. It is something inherent in and radiating from it. Love is not a higher power which descends upon us, nor a duty which is imposed upon us. It is our own human power by which we relate ourselves to the world and make it truly our own. It is with this affirming view of our humanity that Fromm calls upon us not to change humanity for the good of society, but to transform society for the good of humanity. Everything we do as a people must be based upon this principle, he says, the sole criterion of ethical value being human welfare, including the reformation of our regulations, institutions, and our laws to ensure every person has the right and opportunities to achieve their fullest potential. The first and foremost of these conditions, he says, is that the unfolding and growth of every person is the aim of all social and political activities. Upon pondering these words, which have inspired my soul, I've begun imagining what the world might be like if we made human well-being and fulfillment the focus of all we do. What would it be like if this were the measure of all things, that by which we determine the purpose and success of our politics, our economics, our healthcare, business, journalism, criminal justice, foreign affairs, the military, religion, the use of our natural resources, and our relationship to the earth, and so many other aspects of life and society? Over the next few weeks and months, I hope to imagine just this, beginning today with the problem of education. As I see it, there are three issues preventing education from being foundational to the successful unfolding of a person. Firstly, public education is shamefully underfunded. Secondly, the exploding cost of higher education puts it out of reach for many, or else indentures college graduates to banks for loans that they may default on or will at least be difficult for most to repay. And thirdly, all education, preschool through college, is increasingly becoming no more than a means of someday getting a job, rather than as a means of becoming a whole human being. Budget cutbacks in recent years have impacted public schools so badly that educators around the country have recently been forced to engage in statewide teacher strikes and protests, beginning in West Virginia, where teachers demanded better wages, more affordable health benefits, legal protections for their unions, an end to the expansion of charter schools, and defeating a plan to eliminate their seniority system. There was another in Oklahoma, where there have been reports that teachers were depending on charity just to eat, where some schools are without heat or air conditioning or even librarians, and where students use textbooks that are falling apart in classes that are overcrowded. And some of the schools there are only open 4 days a week because they can't afford to be open for five. The teachers' strike in Kentucky occurred after its governor announced he planned to eliminate their pension plan. In a state where teachers still don't get to participate in the Social Security system. This is because the original Social Security Act excluded state and local workers since the federal government did not have the right to tax them. Since then, state laws have mostly been amended to accommodate them, but there remain 15 states, including Kentucky, representing about 1 million teachers who don't pay into Social Security and cannot rely upon it in their retirement. In Colorado, where the average teacher's salary is almost $14,000 below the national average, educators went on strike to protest underfunded schools and the scaling back of their benefits, among a list of other grievances. And in Arizona, they went on strike demanding education funding be returned just to its pre-recession levels and that teachers' salaries be brought up on par with the rest of the nation, or at least the national average. These are extreme examples of what's going on just in the U.S., the so-called wealthiest nation on earth. In fact, somebody told me between services that Colombia's national budget spends almost 15% on education. We're somewhere between 4 and 6. But in the new paradigm of human fulfillment, human well-being can no longer be measured by the success or the failure of one nation or one group of people. It must be based on the welfare of all human beings, everywhere. Fortunately, the members of the United Nations, representing 206 of 260 countries and states around the world, have already agreed that education is a human right. Here's what our international covenant says about it. Education is both a human right in itself and an indispensable means of realizing other human rights. As an empowerment right, education is the primary vehicle by which economically and socially marginalized adults and children can lift themselves out of poverty and obtain the means to participate fully in their communities. Education has a vital role in empowering women, safeguarding children from exploitive and hazardous labor and sexual exploitation, promoting human rights and democracy, protecting the environment and controlling population growth. Increasingly, education is recognized as one of the best financial investments states can make. But the importance of education is not just practical, it says. A well-educated, enlightened, and active mind able to wander freely and widely is one of the joys and rewards of human existence. These sentiments most certainly express an ethic in which human welfare and fulfillment is central. Under the UN agreement, Its member states, including the United States, are obligated to undertake steps to assure such education exists in their domains, that measures are taken to guarantee the right of education is available to every individual in the shortest possible time using the maximum available resources. To use those resources effectively and to make certain that there are no obstacles preventing anyone, especially marginalized groups, from accessing quality education. This all sounds great, doesn't it? And knowing our international heart is in the right place should give us hope. But alas, the most recent UN report from September last year states that a total of 263 million children and young people remain out of school, including 61 million children of primary school age. Sub-Saharan Africa and Southern Asia account for 70% of the global population that is out of school at the primary and secondary levels of education. Those among the demographics whose rights to education is most violated include, as you might expect, poor children, rural children, minority children, girl children, indigenous children, and children with disabilities. During the next 15 years, as part of its sustainable development plan, the UN hopes to, in its words, focus on eliminating discrimination and promoting equity and inclusion to identify and address the barriers in bringing the right to education to the world's world's remaining eligible learners who are not in school. But right now, including the United States, most countries don't have the political or the economic will to prevent a global system of child neglect when it comes to education. 700 billion of the recently passed $1.3 trillion U.S. budget, more than 50% of it, will go to military spending, while education funding has been reduced by $9 billion since last year to $59 billion, about 6% at most of the budget, and eliminates 30 programs. This is so even though in recent years we've learned the military is unable to account for how it has spent trillions of missing dollars. Clearly, the education of our children is neither a national nor global priority. Since I graduated from college in 1986, furthermore, the cost of higher education has risen almost 550%. That's twice as fast as medical costs have risen, making it almost five times more expensive than it was back then. According to a recent article in Forbes magazine, two-thirds of students graduating from American colleges and universities are graduating with some level of debt. The average borrower will graduate with $26,600 in the red, representing $1 trillion in federal student loan debt, about 6% of our national debt. The average loan will end up costing a graduate closer to $40,000, however, by the time it's paid back, if it's paid back, in 10 years. And that's a big if, considering growth wages and income have remained mostly flat, unless you're a CEO, since 1980. To my mind, it's time for all of us to begin wondering if we've reached a break-even point and if a college degree still justifies this tremendous expense. When young people graduate with debt that they may default on because salaries haven't risen with the cost of higher education and they can't afford to pay their bills on what they make, let alone make their loan payments, it's time to rethink and to reframe what's happening. Since college degrees are still required to find work, because because the unemployment rate for college graduates right now is at 2.2% compared to 5.3% for those with high school degrees alone and 7.7% for those with less than a high school degree. And since most graduates are indebted to the banking industry in order to find work, we have a situation that we could call indentured servitude and extortion, wherein young people must pay a percentage of their subsistence income just to have the right to work and eke out some sort of living. And this brings me to the third issue that I see with education today, that it has been linked too closely with employment. While higher education has always helped determine the course of a graduate's career, it has traditionally been about shaping well-rounded individuals by exposing them to a liberal arts education, by exposing them, that is, to a variety of disciplines. It wasn't about producing good employees, but birthing open-minded people. Getting a job is the promise, often an empty promise, of the exploding for-profit college industry, which has turned, or in turn, has forced so-called nonprofit colleges to follow their lead by de-emphasizing liberal arts in favor of career-oriented education. Even more troubling, as far as I'm concerned, is that this trend is increasingly becoming the primary emphasis of public education, too. The acronym STEM, which stands for Science, Technology, Engineering, and Math, represents the U.S. government's emphasis upon teaching kids these skills from preschool through 12th grade, so as the Obama administration put it, kids will have the chance to reach their full potential. While these areas can be rewarding and meaningful and important for those drawn to them, they are no less so than the fields of art and history and literature and music and philosophy may be for others. Reducing the emphasis on public education and human potential to just four technical areas suggests its purpose is to make good employees, not whole people. To truly give our kids a chance to reach their full potential, their education must be broadly based and adequately funded. As I play with the idea of what this might look like, with human well-being as our measuring stick, I imagine all nations, ours included, that spend more on books than bombs, more on teachers than technology, and more on students than on student loans. In short, I imagine a world of countries that make education the cornerstone of what they do, the foundation of their future, by using it to empower the children of the world to truly achieve their fullest potential. Of course, this means exposing them to science and technology and engineering and math, as much as it means opening their minds to art and history and music and philosophy and so much more. It means, as Fromm says, seeing them not as a means to somebody else's end, but as an end in themselves, as beings that should not only have the right to an education, but a right to blossom and a right to discover and a right to become. When it comes to higher education, I envision requiring and offering a two-year liberal arts education as part of the publicly supported education system. Right? Publicly supported. Thank you. This means, after graduating from high school, I know some high school educators and high school students are coming out with really solid educations on a lot of the basic stuff right now. So we can have a post high school liberal arts education that follows that excellent education. So this means after graduating from high school that they'll continue their education by being exposed to a world of ideas with the intention of opening their minds to many possibilities, to diversity, and to finding a path that's right for them. And once that path is found, they can continue their education through a joint effort between universities and employers, offering classes and hands-on learning in the field so students end up with practical skills, experience, and contacts in the areas in which they choose to work. The expense of this can be shared again by public universities and the companies and organizations benefiting from having young people working with them during these internships. Most importantly, we must shift our paradigm, as the United Nations has already done, to recognize that education is a human right that exists not merely as a hoop to jump through to qualify somebody for work, but as a necessary tool for helping us to develop our own humanity. Because again, as our international covenant already recognizes, the importance of education is not just practical. A well-educated, enlightened, and active mind able to wander freely and widely is one of the joys and rewards of human existence. Thank you. Thank you.
Well, our closing hymn today actually supports the vision of what this kind of education could do for us. And it is in your hymnal if you need to look at that. It's one we haven't done for a while. It's number 139. But you're certainly welcome to use the screen also. It's called Wonders Still the World Shall Witness. Please rise as you're willing and able.
Shall make it.
So now, we all are teachers, so go and model an education that is wise, hopeful, and respectful cultivation of learning in the belief that all people you encounter should have the chance to share in life. Amen. Blessed be. Salam alaikum, shalom, and namaste.
Shalom.